Hello everyone, David here, MixBusTV. Hope you're having a great day. In this video, I'm gonna try to reply one of the most common questions still that I get asked. How do I get more clients as a mix or mastering engineer? And I wanted to do this video because I feel like most people go about it in the wrong way, arguably in the worst possible way. Let's talk about it.
Okay, that's cool. You just push it a little further and do it a little further. Okay. But that's fine.
Hello everyone, welcome back to MixBusTV. Hope you're having a great day. Before we start, please check the info box down below for my mixing courses on ProMix Academy, free plugins, discounts, and special offers. And if you want to support the channel, but most important, access to the already big and always growing library of in-depth professional mix and mastering courses, videos, and tutorials here on the channel. Members only, exclusive content, and much more. Click the join button down here. See all the perks of becoming a MixBusTV member, which includes mix consultations with me via Skype or email. Let's get to the video. So this is still one of the most common questions that I get asked all the time. How do I get more clients as a mixer, mastering engineer? And that's normal because with the digital era, what happened is it's a lot easier and a lot less costly to get a studio running, some sort of studio. Whether it's a recording studio, whether it's a mix and mastering room. Because of that, a lot of people started offering services as a mix and mastering engineer. Just like releasing music before, it was hard, it was expensive, you needed a proper studio, that was the only way to do it, and then you needed distribution, you needed a label, it was almost unthinkable to do it independently. Now, everybody with a computer can and does release music pretty much every day. Now, just like with everything else, when something becomes easily accessible and cheap, it's a double-edged sword. On one hand, it's a positive because a lot of talented people that otherwise couldn't either release their music or try to start a career as a mix and master engineer couldn't do it without a pretty substantial investment and risk. Now they can. On the other hand, a lot of people that have no business in either releasing music or offering services as a mix and master engineer can easily do it. Open a website, take a couple of pictures. Actually, some people got caught stealing pictures from other studios and make it look like it's theirs, and advertise yourself as a mix and master engineer. This, of course, created two things. One, there's a lot of crappy services out there. And second, it flooded the market, so to speak, with so much offering that is more than the demand. And when this happens, everyone starts to lower their rates to get that gig on that guy because there's 10 dogs fighting for one bone. And I see so many people lowering rates until it's the bottom of the barrel. And that is, first of all, very embarrassing. I see people offering mix and mastering for like $100 or $150. I've seen even lower rates than that. Now, in this business, fortunately, usually you get what you pay. So just so we are clear, this is not a rant on my part. I'm good. This doesn't really affect people who already have their career, so to speak, going and healthy, okay? It's, like I said at the beginning of the video, is to try to help talented people that I see they're talented. And most of them are my students, okay? Members or people that book private lessons with me. But I'm digressing. Let's go back to the original subject. How do you get more clients as an inspiring mix and master engineer who starts their career, their path? And keep in mind, this is just my advice. It's not one way to do things. But I can tell you for what I've seen during the years I've been in the business for a long time, the one thing that almost never works, which is lowballing your business and lowering your rates to the bottom of the barrel. First of all, it makes you look really bad. Because what can you expect? The price tag already says everything. But isn't this for everything else? You go buy a car and there's a $10,000 car and a $100,000 car. You don't even need to look at the two cars. You know which one is better, right? You go buy a computer and you find a laptop that is $350 and another one that is $1,300. You know which one is going to be better. So that's the first thing. How much you ask already puts you in a certain bracket of the market. And this is the biggest mistake. By lowballing your business, you target a certain type of client, which is a client that probably will have problems even paying you $100. I am sure 100% there's a lot of people out there that will see this video and they experienced asking $150. You don't even pay electricity with that. And then have to lower that price to maybe 90 to get that gig. What the hell does that to you? Nothing, absolutely nothing. And some people will say, oh, I have to build my portfolio. Well, you know what? At that point, if you have to work for that amount of money, you're better off working for free. Because you're probably the same person with $90 or $100 more or less in your pocket, but you set a precedent for your work. You're worth $100. You know how hard it is to have clients that know that your rates are $100 to bring it to 500 or 6 or 900 or 1200? And some people do it this way. Don't get me wrong, but this was some time ago when there wasn't this much offering, because you know, the 10 clients that you have that are used to pay you $100, if you raise your rate to 150, they're probably gonna go to the other guy that now does 100 or 90. And third, these guys are probably not serious about their music and about their careers, because I can tell you this, the investment for mix and mastering compared to the investment that you need to actually make a dent in any market in the music is 10%. So if those guys don't have the money to pay for mix and mastering, believe me, they will not have the money to pay for everything else that it's needed to get a song or a career or an album going. Not even close. And knowing this, if you think about it, and I'm gonna keep the numbers below the minimum, but let's say to get a song going, as in you get it in front of a handful of people more than just your friends and your circles on social media, you need $10,000, okay? Between a decent video, promotion, and everything else. Who in their right mind would risk a $10,000 investment for how little it is and insignificant in the music business with $100, $150 mix and mastering? Nobody that is serious would risk something like this, would risk any substantial investment and promote a song, which, by the way, is still the most important thing, because you can gift wrap everything and even spray paint it gold and roll it in glitter. But if it's a turd, when you open the box, it's still a turd. So nobody in their right mind will risk any investment and cheap out in the most important thing. And I already know some people will comment by saying, oh, the song is important, the song is king, the mix is not that important. And that's so stupid. The song, as in the songwriting, the arrangement, is king, is what makes people sing along. But the mix and the mastering are the delivery. Even better, the mix and mastering are your first impression. And you can't have a second first impression. They are the paint on your car. Isn't this for everything? When you see a girl or a guy, how long does it take your brain to understand if you like that person or not? 10 seconds, 30? That's your mix and mastering, is your first impression. And if your mix and mastering is not okay and is not up to par, and I will talk about this in a minute, but let's say it has something that is off. Let's see someone introduce you a friend and this guy or girl smells bad. What's your first impression? I don't want to be next to this person. I'm not going to give this person an hour of my time to try to know him or know her because I'm uncomfortable, like he smells bad, right? Isn't the mix and mastering the same thing? I had to scroll through 500 remixes to pick the winners for the contest. And I was trying to be as fair as humanly possible to all the winners. So even if the mix wasn't that great, I was just forcing myself to listen to it and listen to the arrangement, listen to the idea, you know, to the rough diamond behind the bad mix. After 250, you can't take it anymore. You just, this is a bad mix. It's, you don't even listen to it. Just, no, scroll, next one. And I wasn't listening songs for my pleasure. I had a job to do and I have work ethic and respect for those people who put the time. Think about people that just listen to music because they want to listen to music and your song is gonna be in a playlist. It's gonna playlist with the best of the world. You wanna compete with the best and you have to be up to par. And what happens when your mix sounds like shit? Nope, they just skip it. They don't know if you used analog or digital or a microwave to mix your song. It's not about that. It's about, is this mixing par with the rest? But this thought is not conscious and active like us, like people that works in the music business, that we analyze mixes. This is a feeling, this is a vibe, this is a gut feeling. When people scroll through tracks in their playlist, they don't analyze the mix. Either it moves them or it doesn't. And if it doesn't, they skip to the next song. They don't even give a song the chance, so pass. But this is gonna be another video. So playing the rebate, lowering rates game, it doesn't do you any good because your clientele, your niche, they will always look for a lower rate. How many mixes and master you have to do minimal wage? It's unthinkable and it's a waste of time. You're better off doing something else. And usually those clients are the most bitchy. They will question anything you do because you're a $100 mix engineer in their mind. You set the tone and they will probably ask you like 15 revisions. And maybe you're super talented, but you're going about it wrong. You understand what I mean? I'm trying to help. It's a little bit like anything free. It's not that great. It's taken for granted. It's just overlooked. So think about it when you play the rebate rate, okay? This brings me to the actual advice. And this is, again, one of the many advices, and I'll try to give more than one, but we talked about this subject before and I gave some before, and I think I never actually sat down and thought about this. So this would be the first time, and I never heard anyone giving this advice. Think this, you are probably not going to get money out of the people that don't have money. We go back to what kind of client you target. If you pick the $50 gigs or $100 gigs for a mix, I'm talking about mixing, okay? Or mixing and mastering, like the whole package. Those people, and this doesn't want to offend anyone, probably don't have the money. They just don't. And it's even worse when you try to convince the people that mixes their own stuff or a home because they don't have the budget to pay a mix engineer, because 90% of the time is just a matter of budget. It's not because they like it. It's because it's either that or they won't release their music. If that's the case, it doesn't matter if you offer them a deal. Oh, look, I usually take $500 and I'm asking you $150. They won't have those $150. It would be like if someone offers me to buy a $2 million car for $1 million. It's a great deal. But if I don't have $1 million, I ain't gonna buy it, you know? So trying to extract money forcefully almost from the people that don't have the mindset of, I want the best product possible and I know I have to invest in a professional that does mix and mastering, ain't gonna work. Because best case scenario, you're gonna get chump change. You're gonna work your ass off. You're gonna fight against probably the client, the mix, the everything, and it's not gonna do you any good. Instead, my advice is, and this is a lot more complicated, try to target the people that already have that mindset, the people that are in the music in a serious manner, that they know that is necessary to have professionals doing that part of the job, and they just don't know who to pick. That is worth pursuing, because first of all, you don't have to have the discussion, is this gonna be free? Is this gonna be like $50? You already know that these guys know the business and know how it's done, and they know they have to pay a professional, right? The game is, why would they pick you? And lowering your rates will not make you look good with these guys, because everybody sees through that. Everybody sees through that in 1 second, okay? Instead, of course, is how you are as a person. This is one extremely important element that a lot of people forget. Even if you have an online relationship with the clients, like 50%, probably more than 50% of my clients are not in US, okay? Or they are not in Los Angeles. And we have an online relationship, but how you are as a person, it's so important, the human relationship that you have with your clients, how flexible you are within, of course, the limits of the agreement. Deliver more than you asked. Okay, that's another thing that it's a good practice. I always do it. You can deliver more, deliver it faster. Okay, give another version or spend 2 more hours on the mix or another day if it's necessary. You know what I'm going with this? I hope I'm passing the message. Follow up for your clients, cheer for your clients, support them. And most important, support everyone who's somehow either successful or not successful, that is around you and around them, okay? This is a community, and I think we really lost this human connection, and everyone is against everybody, and everyone critiques anything. Oh, your music is shit, or this one is crap. Like, what good does it do to you If you suck at mix and mastering, talking shit about someone else, it won't do you any good. It actually makes you look really bad. Or if you're good and you think you deserve more clients or more whatever, talking shit about someone else will not do you any good and will not make you look good at all. But again, I'm going on a tangent. So try to target those kind of musicians and artists, okay, that are in the right mindset and not the people that either they're not willing to spend because they believe that you don't need anything and you don't need to learn anything and you don't need skills nor to put effort in anything and you're gonna blow up just because you deserve it and you're so special. And that's the other thing. Unfortunately, nobody gives a damn how much effort you put in your song. Let's say you mix and master in your own stuff and you spend like a month on it and it sounds the best that it can, but it doesn't sound up to par. People don't care how much effort you put in it. People listen to the final result. People don't care. So when people say the user doesn't know where it was mixed or what was used, think the other way around as well. People don't care how much time you spent on it or if you poured blood and sweat on it. If it's not up to par, skip in the playlist. The second important advice, and I hope eye-opening for those who are serious in starting this career, mix and mastering is a career, just like any other business and career. You think you're gonna be able to start and blow up without investing anything? I'm sorry if I'm pissing on someone's dreams, but it's no different than any other business, especially when there's so much competition. I wouldn't even say competition because, like I said before, a lot of it is just people with a computer opening a site, but a lot of offer and a lot of clutter and everyone's feed is full of like people offering and offering and offering. Even more, you should be in the mindset that you're starting a business. Now the business in this case is you and your skills. You have to invest in your own business, whether it's learning, whether it's gear, equipment, and most important, PR and advertisement. Just like everyone else, just like every other business. You probably need someone if you can't do it yourself, and you can't really do it yourself. Who knocks on doors and get connections with people, with artists, labels, promoters, other PRs, you name it. You want someone that does the PR for you. Because even if you have the skills, what you're gonna do, you're gonna go and promote yourself. You know how bad that looks? It doesn't work that way. And those people don't do it for free if they're good, just like a mix engineer. And that's a type of advertisement. Then there's the other type of advertisement, which is today social media and all that. But pay attention to that because everybody's doing it. And I still see people advertising shit for $100 because there's so much of it. Even the advertisements are saturated. We see so much crap, even in the advertisements themselves. Like you can tell it's crap. So pay attention, the car salesman pitch. And I see so many people, even other channels do it. It really doesn't work. I think people can, you know, see through it. And I am at the opposite extreme. I don't do that. I never did that. And probably I should a little bit at least, but you get my point. So just like my video on Billie Eilish and, you know, artists in general coming out and becoming famous or having a successful career, it's really hard that you're gonna come out from the forest just because you're so amazing, okay? First of all, because there's a lot of talented people. And second, because talent alone, just like for musicians, it's necessary, but it will not necessarily get you where you wanna be or anywhere sometimes. It's necessary because when you have the chance to prove yourself, your mix better be good, better be better than the next guy. And better be, you know, up to par with everybody else. Otherwise, your chance will be blown. So that's another thing. Make sure that you are prepared and you are up to par before actually start that part of the business. So the investment in expanding your brand, your name, your work, your portfolio. A lot of people put out their portfolio and they're not ready. That's not gonna do you any good. You know, even if you work for free and your mix is like, that's, you know, that's not gonna do you any good, okay? So I think this is it for this video. Like I said, I hope this is gonna be helpful. I know it's gonna be helpful for at least those guys that are serious about this. And if you like the video, please don't forget to leave a like and share. Comment down below, let me know what you think. And if you actually want to start improving your mix and mastering skills, click the join button down here. Access to the members only exclusive content. Ask any of the members if it's worth it or not. Subscribe if you haven't already. Stay safe. See you next time. Hands on my neck, hands grip my throat, throat. Lift me.